Going to look at verses 9 through 12a, that is the first half of verse 12. And the title of this sermon is Filled with the Knowledge of God's Will. Filled with the Knowledge of God's Will. And I want to begin by reading these 3.5 verses. Beginning in verse 9. For this reason also, since the day we heard of it, we have not ceased to pray for you and to ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of His will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, to please Him in all respects, bearing fruit in every good work, and increasing in the knowledge of God, strengthened with all power, according to His glorious might, for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience, joyously giving thanks to the Father. Well, it has been well said that words start wars. And the very first words that have started a war on this earth were the words, "Has God really said?" These words uttered by the great enemy of our soul, Satan himself, to Eve as he challenged God's word. This was the start of the longest and the greatest war, a war that is ongoing even to this present day. And it is a war that each and every single one of us here this morning and everywhere in the world is engaged in. And it is the war for your mind. The war for your mind. As with Adam and Eve, the devil knows that if he has the person's mind, he has the person. Because our minds, how we think, our intellect, emotions, our wills, our minds, this directs and generates all of our actions. It controls everything we do. Everything we do begins with the mind. As a man thinks, so he is. And the scriptures teach that because of Adam's sin, sin entered into the world, man now has a fallen mind. Ephesians 4:17 says that the Gentiles walk in the futility of their mind, in the emptiness of their mind. Man has a corrupt mind which can only be renewed through Christ. And I trust that most of us here this morning have experienced such a renewal. You have been made into new creatures in Christ through faith in Him. And that you have an inheritance waiting for you in heaven, an eternal home. And that cannot be taken away from you. Whomever the Son sets free is free indeed. And the devil knows that. The devil knows that he can't steal your salvation. But because we are still in the flesh and we wrestle with the flesh, we can still be deceived to an extent. And Satan knows that if he can target and enter our minds, then he can keep us from being fruitful, from walking in a manner that is pleasing to the Lord. And Paul understood that. And so with these saints at Colossae, after thanking the Father for their faith and the production of the fruit of love in the Spirit, love which is the fulfillment of the law, he goes on in our passage this morning to pray and to ask God that these Colossians, and by extension, all of us as Christians, would have the right mind that we need to live the right life in Christ. And he begins this in verse 9. This is the first heading. It is Paul's petition. Paul's petition. Verse 9. For this reason also, since the day we heard of it. This means because of the great report that Epaphras brought to us of your position in Christ. Since the day we heard of your faith and of the love that you have for all the saints, Paul says, we have not ceased to pray for you. And so even though the saints at Colossae seem to be doing well, they seem to be producing love, which is the greatest evidence of salvation, even though they seem to be walking just fine, Paul, nevertheless, he prays for them. Last week, we saw that he prayed to thank God. This week, he's praying to ask God. What is he asking God for? To ask that you may be filled with the knowledge of his will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding. This is Paul's petition. He is asking God to fill these saints with the knowledge of God's will. Now, the word filled means to increase or to be made complete. But many have pointed out that it has this idea of control, to control. Okay, let me explain what I mean. A great example is found in Ephesians 5:18. Paul says there, do not get drunk with wine, for that is dissipation, but instead be filled with the Holy Spirit. When a person is drunk with wine, you could say they are filled with wine, to the point where this substance controls their mind, leading them to do things they would not otherwise do. When someone is enraged and angry and throwing things and punching things, you would say that person is filled with rage. And that's the idea here. Paul is asking God to fill these saints with the knowledge of his will to the point where their lives is controlled by that knowledge, to the point where they are driven by that knowledge of his will. Now, the word knowledge here, there are many words that are translated knowledge in the Bible. Gnosis, where you hear the word knowledge, gnosis, that's not the word we find here. The word knowledge in this verse is the word epignosis. Epignosis. And both, again, can be translated knowledge, but there is a difference. Gnosis refers often to intellectual knowledge, which may or may not affect a person's actions. In other words, it's just head knowledge. Epignosis, on the other hand, refers to a clear, exact, complete, full, real knowledge that always affects and impacts and influences the form of religious life. In other words, this is a knowledge here in verse 9 that leads to a conduct, that leads to an action. It is not mere head knowledge. J.B. Lightfoot said this, this Greek word, epignosis, was used especially of the knowledge of God and of Christ as being the perfection of knowledge. And so it seems clear that Paul is already combating the false, errant, limited knowledge of the heretics that had entered the church at Colossae. He's saying, this is the knowledge you need, the full knowledge of God's will. And this is where the Christian life begins. It is with knowledge, with the mind. That's where the Christian life begins. A lack of biblical knowledge leads to ruin. Hosea 4:6 says, my people are destroyed for a lack of knowledge. Israel was destroyed because they forsook the law of God. Lack of knowledge leads to a ruined life. And notice Paul says, in all spiritual wisdom and understanding. This further defines this type of knowledge. It's not just head knowledge. It's knowledge in all spiritual wisdom and understanding. It is a knowledge that goes beyond the head. And the word all here is found all over this passage. Paul keeps saying it, all, all. And this indicates a completion that we have in Christ. The full knowledge, complete knowledge, all wisdom, all spiritual understanding. Now these two words, wisdom and understanding, they are synonymous terms. They're almost identical. But some have suggested a distinction between the word wisdom and the word understanding. The word wisdom, some have said, it is utilizing knowledge with common sense and insight. You could say arranging knowledge in a concise way in one's mind. While understanding refers to the actual practical application of that wisdom. And one commentator says that wisdom goes beyond knowledge. Wisdom is above knowledge, because if you have knowledge, you can be puffed up. You can be conceited. And commentators say that wisdom is bound up with our moral life. And it's interesting, wisdom in the Bible is only ever used of God and of the righteous person, unless it is being used sarcastically of the unrighteous person. But knowledge is used across the board. Knowledge puffs up. We're talking about a knowledge here that goes beyond the mere mind. A knowledge that leads you to live in a certain way. And notice that both virtues of wisdom and understanding are described as spiritual. Spiritual wisdom. Spiritual understanding. This is a wisdom that begins and originates and comes from God. It is spiritual wisdom. It is not earthly wisdom. Because if you notice in Colossians 2:23, Paul says that the false teaching that these heretics were bringing into the church had an appearance of wisdom. Their teaching, their theology, what they told you to do and not do, it seemed like the wise thing to do. It seemed like there were some spiritual benefits to it. But God, Paul says this was an appearance of wisdom, vain wisdom, smoke and mirrors, empty wisdom. That is counterfeit knowledge. Real knowledge, true wisdom, is found in Christ alone. And it is this kind of true knowledge and this kind of spiritual wisdom that you and I, we need if we are to please God. Now, if knowledge of God's will is so important, and it is, if that is where life begins for us as Christians, then the question we have to ask is, how do we get it? Or where do we get it? How do we get this knowledge of God's will? Because the action in the filling, being filled, has God as the one doing the action. He is the one filling the person with the knowledge of His will. But God is a God of means. So how do we get this knowledge? Does it happen when we are sleeping? Does it happen through some kind of osmosis in a mystical way? No, we get God's knowledge in His Word, in the Scriptures. The will of God is the Word of God. And the will of God here in this verse is what God wants us to do, how He wants us to think and to walk and to speak. Be filled with the knowledge of what God's will is for your life. And God has not left us to try to discern this knowledge through tea leaves or signs. It is in His Word. Let me give you a few verses. Paul said in Romans 12:2, "Do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind." For what purpose? So that you may prove what the will of God is, that which is good and acceptable and perfect. Now, how do we renew our minds? We renew our minds through the Word of God. Colossians 3:16. Let the Word of Christ richly dwell within you with all wisdom. The word of Christ is the Bible. It is the word, these words on a page. And the will of God is clearly spelled out right here. Let me give you just two verses. It is God's will for us to be sanctified. 1 Thessalonians 4:3. For this is the will of God, your sanctification, that is, that you abstain from sexual immorality. Paul says, this is the will of God, your sanctification. In that context is abstain from sexual immorality, but sanctification involves everything in the Christian life. Another example is 1 Peter 2:15. It is God's will for us to do the right thing. For such is the will of God, that by doing right, you may silence the ignorance of foolish men. Now, it is God's will, and we are commanded, each and every single one of us, to know His will. Ephesians 5:17. So then, do not be foolish. Don't be a fool. But understand what the will of the Lord is. How important is it to do the will of God? How important is it? Jesus said in Matthew 7:21 that it is those who do the will of the Father who are going to heaven. Doesn't mean that we work for our salvation. It means that if we are truly saved, we're going to be doing the will of God. We're going to be marked out by doing the will of God. We can't do the will of God if we don't know the will of God. Amen? It starts in the mind. It starts with the Word of God. Now, obviously, that involves prayer. Because notice that's where Paul starts. He's praying and asking God to fill them. And in Ephesians 1, I believe, verse 14 or 15, he says that he's praying for the saints that God would fill them with a spirit of wisdom and of revelation in the knowledge of Him. So as we study the Word, we're praying for God to fill us with this knowledge. But knowledge is not an end of itself. Because notice, Paul says in verse 10, this is the second heading, he says, so that, be filled with the knowledge of His will for this purpose, so that you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, to please Him in all respects. So this is the purpose for the knowledge. The word walk here means to live. To live. It refers to a manner of life, to a conduct. The Jews would speak of two roads and two ways and two walks because they pictured life as a journey that one would walk. And you were either walking the right way according to the ways of the Lord or you're not. This is the walk that is in view here. And this is the purpose for being filled with the knowledge of God. Now, in contrast to the verb be filled that we found in verse 9, where God is doing the action of filling, the one doing the action here is the Christian. That you will walk in a manner worthy of the Lord. Now, that seems obvious, but it needs to be stressed. You see, God provides you with the knowledge that you need to please Him, but He's not going to walk for you. He's not going to walk for me. You have to walk out your faith. I have to walk out my faith. We can't blame God if we're not walking in a manner worthy of the Lord. It's a command for us to obey. And notice, it's a manner worthy of the Lord. This refers to a manner deserving of Christ, a manner that reflects that He is the Lord of your life. You're walking in such a way that people look at you and they say, Jesus Christ is this person's Lord. This person lives his life, her life, in obedience to the Word of God. Does that reflect your life? Does that reflect my life? If it doesn't, it may be that we're not being filled with the Word of God. And this walk requires us to please Him in all respects, Paul says. And to please Him means to yield to the will of Christ and to forsake our own will. It means to do what God wants you to do and not what you want to do. It is dying to self. It is dying daily and following Christ, picking up your cross, obeying the will of God. And he says again, the word all. Not in some respects, but in all respects. Completely, total submission to the Word of God. Absolutely submitted. Are you guys absolutely submitted to the Word of God? I'm not. Right? We can't panic here. We are all a work in progress. None of us have arrived. And the Colossians haven't arrived, otherwise Paul wouldn't be telling them to be filled with the knowledge and to walk. And by the way, Paul didn't arrive because in Philippians 3, he says, I have not attained to it yet, but I press on, I am moving forward, reaching up to Christ, pressing on to the prize of the upward call of God in Christ Jesus. Paul hadn't arrived. So let's not get frustrated. Remember that he's using great language here, hyperbole. He's saying you have to be completely submitted to the Word of God while also knowing that that's not attainable in this life. We're all being progressively sanctified, conformed into the image of Christ. God is molding us, and we're all at different levels of maturity in our walk. But we're all moving forward in Jesus Christ. But here's the thing. And this is important. Understanding that we won't reach the perfect state on earth does not give us an excuse for sin. We can't have respectable sins in our lives, sins that we don't consider all that bad. We can't have sins in our life that we label as a little white lie. There is no such thing. A lie is a lie. There is no small sin with God. And so let's not take the knowledge that we will never arrive on earth and say, well, therefore, I'll just sin here a little bit because I'm never going to reach perfection. Because in the Bible, what we find is that the bar never lowers. And the standard is Jesus Christ Himself. You've been predestined to be conformed into the image of His Son. And so we are becoming more like Christ as we go here on earth. We must press on to righteousness, each and every single one of us. So Paul is saying that knowledge of God's Word results in godly living. It begins with the Word, with the mind. A theologian said that the end of all knowledge, the apostle would say, results in conduct. And so let's not say we have knowledge, biblical knowledge, if our life doesn't reflect it. The Pharisees had an intellectual knowledge, and they were hypocrites. Real, true knowledge in the Bible is demonstrated, as Dennis read, or as is found in James, by the right conduct. Now, what does this walk look like? This walk worthy of Christ, what does it look like? I'm glad you guys asked. You ask all the right questions. Paul gives us in the rest of our passage four characteristics of the worthy walk. Four characteristics of the worthy walk. Now, this is not all that's to be said about the worthy walk. These are just four evidences of that walk, okay? And the first is that the Christian who is walking in a manner worthy of the Lord bears fruit. Paul says, bearing fruit in every good work. Now, Jesus said in Matthew 7 that a good tree will produce good fruit. In the parable of the sower, or the soils, it says that when the word is planted in a good soil, a believing heart, a true Christian, it produces fruit. Some 30, some 60, some 100. Different levels of fruit, but nevertheless, a true Christian is going to produce fruit. That is the teaching that we find here. If the knowledge of God's will is ingrained in your mind, it's going to result in a worthy walk with a characteristic, one of which is that you're going to bear fruit. To bear fruit means to produce actions and natural consequences befitting one's nature. The idea is that of a tree bearing fruit of its own kind. Right? So an apple tree is going to produce apples. A spirit-indwelt Christian is going to produce spiritual fruit. That's the idea here. If our nature has been changed in Christ, it's going to result in a new life. It's inevitable for you to have been filled with the Holy Spirit and remain as you once were before. It's impossible, the Bible says. If God has changed your life, if God lives in you, he's going to change you. He's going to mold you. He's going to conform you. Jesus said in John 15:8, "My Father is glorified by this, that you bear much fruit and so prove to be my disciples." You see, the fruit is the proof in the pudding, right? The fruit is the proof that we're a disciple. And notice that Paul, in our passage at least, does not give a list of good works here. And why is that? It is because it's assumed that if we are being filled with the knowledge of God, that we're going to know what the works are that we need to be doing. Like we read in the few examples I gave you of God's will. If we are being filled with the knowledge of God's word, we're going to know what to do. We're going to know how to walk, right? Paul does not give us a list. And you see, the difficulty here is not so much outlining what God wants us to do. Where the rubber meets the road is in the area of submission to the Word of God. Submission to the Word of God. Are you going to submit to what God says in His Word? That's where the difficulty is for us. Any one of us can find the will of God. The question that we have to ask is, are we going to submit to the Word of God? Are we going to obey the Word of God? Second characteristic of a worthy walk is that the Christian will increase in the knowledge of God. Paul says, and increasing in the knowledge of God. Still in verse 10, second half. Now this could be read, growing by the knowledge of God. So another key characteristic of the worthy walk is that you're going to be growing in the knowledge of God. Same word here, epignosis. It's found twice, so it must be important. As the Christian is walking, he is also growing through the knowledge of God's word. And so you have producing fruit. This is the external growth. And then increasing in knowledge, this is our internal growth. Right? And so this points to the fact that, again, we're all a work in progress. Otherwise, we wouldn't need to grow. Increasing in the knowledge of God. Gebelin, one of the commentators, said, "What rain and sunshine are to the nurture of plants, the knowledge of God is to the growth and maturing of the spiritual life." When my father-in-law left PA to come here to the West, when we left PA, everything was green and beautiful. There were trees and grass and water and deer and bunnies jumping around and squirrels. And as we began to drive through the other states in the East, the same thing. A lot of life, grass, trees. But once we entered Texas and began to drive west and west and west, it seemed as if everything was dying before my very eyes. Everything was drying out. Just a shrubbery here and a shrubbery there. No animals, nothing. Why? Because there's not as much water here. And I think that's the picture of many Christians' lives. They start off, they get saved, they're on fire for the Lord. They're reading the Word. They're nurturing their faith. They're in fellowship. They're in prayer. There's growth. There's life. But as they go on through life, they become more lazy in their time in the Word, more lazy in prayer, not as much time at church, not as much time in fellowship. And their life just dries out. Not completely dead. There's a shrubbery here and there. You're not going to die completely. But it's pathetic. It's pathetic. Why? Because there's not as much nurturing of your faith. You're not showering your life with the Word of God. Been waiting to use that illustration for a long time. So the Christian is someone who grows by the knowledge of God's Word and in the knowledge of God's Word and continues to grow until the day that he or she goes on to be with the Lord. There is no retirement in the Christian life. You're to continue to grow more and more, no matter how old you are, no matter how old or how long you've been walking with the Lord. It is a continual growth until you reach perfection and glory. Third characteristic of the worthy walk is spiritual strength. Spiritual strength. Paul says, strengthened with all power according to his glorious might, for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience joyously. It is really nice to read the Word in its full context, isn't it? Because until now, you would probably think, man, I have to bear fruit and increase in knowledge and do good deeds by my own power. It's all left up to me. Paul says, no. He says, strengthened with all power. God doesn't leave us to try and pull ourselves by our own bootstraps. He strengthens us. Notice the word all again. Strengthened with all power, complete power. God doesn't leave us to try to walk out our walk by ourselves. He empowers us. He strengthens us. And the word strengthen here means to enable, to become rendered more capable or able for some task. And so the Christian is being enabled to walk worthily by God's all-enabling, all-encompassing power. And the word power here is the word dunamis in the Greek, which emphasizes inward spiritual or moral vigor. It is having a strength that is not necessarily manifest physically. This is important. This is inner strength. It is fortitude. It is power residing in one's nature, or it is again, moral vigor. And by the way, the words increasing in the knowledge of God, the word increasing and strengthen here are both in the present tense in the Greek, which means that it is a continual, ongoing action. A commentator put it this way: when you get saved, God doesn't wind you up like a little toy and then let you go and your power just drains out. So he doesn't just give you some power and then, here you go, go off on your own. The picture is of like a Niagara Falls, of all this power, this water just being poured out constantly into the Christian, increasing, strengthened by the power of God. This word for power is the same word we find in Philippians 4:13, where Paul says, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. What things was Paul talking about? Benching 900 pounds? Knocking a guy out in a cage fight? Winning a Super Bowl? Building a business empire? Now, in the context of Philippians 4, Paul says, I am strengthened to endure all of the trials of life. Inner strength to endure the trials of life. Whether you're in poverty or prosperity, riches, rags, imprisoned, free, God was strengthening Paul inside to endure imprisonment, to be content in every situation. Inner strength. And if you walk with the Lord will enable you to walk with Him. God does not call us to do something without equipping us to do it. And how does He empower us? How does He empower you? Through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit. A few verses later, Paul says in Colossians 1:29, "For this purpose also I labor, striving according to His power, not my power, which mightily works within me." He was talking about the power of God inside, God indwelling him, empowering him. Have you ever gotten to a point in your Christian walk where you're like, I'm going to give up, I'm going to walk away, and all of a sudden you just gain this new strength to persevere? God's not going to let you just walk away. When you're at your worst, He empowers you and He keeps you and He strengthens your faith. And notice the source of the strength according to His glorious might. The word glorious or glory refers to the majesty of God. A commentator said it is the weightiness of God. And it is a word often tied to His attributes. And so this is glorious power. And the word power there is actually the word kratos, which is only ever used of God. Only ever used of God. This is God power. Supernatural power. This is the source from which our power is being drawn. Omni power. All power. Complete power. This is the word we find in Ephesians 1:19, where Paul says that the Father used this power to raise Christ from the grave. That is the power that is strengthening the Christian. The same power. That is the kind of power available to you this morning in Christ. To what end? Notice Paul says, for the attaining of all steadfastness and patience joyously. Notice the word all again. All. Complete patience. All steadfastness. All patience. Now the words steadfastness and patience are, again, very similar words, but there is a distinction. Steadfastness connotes the ability to bear up under difficult circumstances. One theologian describes steadfastness as the brave patience with which the Christian contends against the various hindrances, persecutions, and temptations that befall him in his conflict with the inward and outward world. Patience, on the other hand, suggests a long-suffering toward people, toward each other, and toward the world. In other words, one steadfastness, one word deals with circumstances in our life, bearing up with those, and the other one refers to bearing up with people. We don't endure by our own power. We don't remain patient by our own strength. This is why God strengthens us, to persevere with patience. And notice the word joyously. This isn't some stubborn, stoic, grumpy patience. It says joyously, with joy. This is supernatural patience. A joyous patience. So what's left to say? Thank you, right? Fourth and final characteristic, thankfulness. A Christian who is walking filled with the knowledge of God will be marked out by thankfulness. Paul is ending here where he began in verse 3. We give thanks to God, the Father. Here he's ending. We give thanks to the Father. Thankfulness for what? Thankfulness for your salvation. Thankfulness for the fruit that you're producing. Thankfulness for your inheritance in heaven. Thankfulness for being filled with his knowledge. Thankfulness for being strengthened to walk out the Christian life. Thankfulness for everything. Every good and perfect gift comes from God. We ought to be thankful for everything. Everything originates with God. Everything. And thankfulness, by the way, is a component in Philippians 4, verses 6 through 8, that ought to be present in our prayers. We ought to pray with thanksgiving, and that leads to a peace that surpasses understanding. How often do we thank God in our prayers for what he's already done for us, for what he's doing? I am blessed. I am blessed when my daughter Selah says thank you, because it tells me that she recognizes that she's been given something, and that makes me want to bless her more. And I'm not saying that that's how God works, but why would God bless us with more knowledge and strength if we're not even thankful for what we already have now? We ought to always give thanks to God. Now, you may be sitting here this morning and you're saying, Pastor Frank, I'm not walking in this way. I'm not filled with this knowledge. I'm not bearing fruit. I'm not increasing. I feel so weak in my Christian walk. I don't have patience or perseverance, and I'm not joyful. What can I do? Well, the first thing is don't panic. Don't despair, because we have a gracious, merciful Father. You can continue to pour rain in your Christian life. So where do you start? And this goes, by the way, whether your Christian life, your Christian walk is dry right now, or whether you're doing great. The first thing you do is start with where Paul started. Ask God. Pray to God to fill you with a spirit of wisdom and revelation and knowledge of him. We start with prayer. We start with prayer. Secondly, very simple, read your Bible. Study your Bible. Meditate on the word. Memorize the word. And if you need help with commentaries, commentators, sound books, and sound authors, come and ask me. I'll point you to the right way. We need to dig deeper into the word of God. 15 minutes in the word in a day is not going to do much when you're being bombarded every day by the fiery darts of Satan. And then third, you must walk this out. Obey what you read in the word. Walk it out. Live it out. And then there's a negative aspect. Those are positives. And this is very important. We're almost done. Please pay attention. This is very important. There's a positive aspect to this. Being in the word, meditating, memorizing. There's a negative aspect to it. Remember, I said we are in a war for our minds. Satan is attacking your mind. How does he do it? There are ads, TV ads, that are tempting you to covet and to be discontent with what you have. There are movies that are tempting you to lust. There are news that are tempting you to fear and to worry. There are books with false doctrines leading you away from the Word of God. There is music with false doctrine leading you away from God. Secular music filling your mind with profanity and blasphemy. Bad company corrupts good character, good morals. We live in a fallen world, in an evil world system. Don't think for a moment that what you read, what you listen to, who you hang out with, will not affect your mind and corrupt your mind. Even cartoons, parents, Even cartoons, most of them have an agenda behind them today. These things will corrupt your mind. Shut it off. Why did Jesus use the example of gouging out your eye and cutting off your hand? He didn't mean it literally. He means it because repentance and getting rid of things in our lives that cause us to sin, getting rid of that is not pleasant. It's painful. It's radical. Is your TV causing you to sin? Throw it out the window. Radical moves. If Satan has your mind, he will have you. And so let the word of Christ richly dwell within you, and everything else will follow. Let's pray. Father, we come to you in the name of your Son, Jesus Christ. So thankful, Lord, for your word. It gives us guidance and a light to walk in the right path, to walk in a manner worthy of the Lord, pleasing him in every respect, increasing by your knowledge, being strengthened with power according to your great might, so that we might be patient as we walk through this life, Lord, as we encounter difficult people, as we bear up when we are falsely accused or insulted. For it is your will for us to suffer, if need be, for doing what is right. And so we pray, God. We pray, give us strength, Lord, to not let evil infiltrate our minds or to excuse sin in our lives that are preventing us from bearing more fruit and in walking in a manner that pleases you more. We want to honor you, Lord. We want to please you. But we can't do it in our own strength. And so we ask, Lord, for your help this morning. In your Son's name, amen.